Welcome to the class of editorial decode, and in this class I will be decoding an unconstitutional judgment written by Suhirt Parthasarthi. Now from examination point of view, this will help you in general studies mains examination paper 2. Plus this is very important for public administration and political science optional students. Now what is this editorial about? This editorial is about how the judiciary has transgressed its mandate to conduct a judicial review. This editorial is also about how judiciary has misread the word consultation given in the Constitution of India in the provision of appointing the judges of the High Court and that of Supreme Court. Now, in order to understand this editorial, we need to know about how this provision, how this judgment is incompatible with the provisions of the Constitution. Now, the Constitution, it has provided with a consultationary process in which the judiciary should be consulted by the President of India before an appointment is made. So there is a word consultation. Now if we look at how the parliamentary form of government works in India, we need to understand Article 74, Article 75 and Article 78. Now all these articles convey that the President has to work on the aid and the advice of the Council of Ministers. So the President, to whomsoever he will be appointing as the judge of the Supreme Court, it is implicit that he has to act on the aid and the advice of the Council of Ministers. Plus, along with that, there should be a consultation process that should be done by the judiciary. President in itself cannot appoint anybody as a judge of the Supreme Court by just consulting with the Chief Justice of India or the senior dignitaries of senior most judges of the Supreme Court. So it is very clear that implicitly and indirectly the executive should also be playing up a role in the appointment of the judges. But Supreme Court in its second judge's case has overread this word consultation. Now they have overread this word consultation as the consensus, as the concurrence of the Supreme Court, concurrence of the Chief Justice of India and the senior most judges of the Supreme Court. Now, by overreading it, it had called the NJAC as unconstitutional. Now, at the face, if we look at the NJAC and its membership of how the judges will be appointed, it stands of political interference, but judiciary wants to keep itself immune from this political pressure, and it is because of this it has called this NJAC as unconstitutional. But if we look at the idealistic provision, not the realistic provision, of how the executive is trying to trample over the domains of not only the legislature but also the judiciary, but also over the regulatory bodies, also over the RBI and a number of other institutions existing in India. Now what we are witnessing is the era of centralization of power by the executive, by the government. On the other hand, the judiciary is trying to protect itself from the transgression that has become very explicit. But if you look at it from the idealistic point of view and from the constitutional point of view, the judiciary's stand is actually wrong. So judiciary has actually tried to balance out between the idealistic realm and between the realistic realm. So what would be the future course of action about the NJAC? Now the Supreme Court might take up the case and the case might be heard by a larger bench. Now the larger bench would be deciding about the NJAC's constitutionality, but for the moment it stands unconstitutional and ultra vires. Now in Keshavananda Bharti case, Supreme Court itself has upheld that the parliament has got the power to amend the constitution, but it has to keep in consideration that the basic structure is not tinkered with, and the appointment thing is something that doesn't fall in this criteria of basic structure of the constitution. If we look it at surfacially, but if we look it at the depth of how this appointment can affect the independence, then this appointment thing and the basic structure of the constitutional feels like as if they are umbilically connected with each other. At the surface, it will look that this is not the part of the basic structure of the constitution. But if we go into deep, if we try to decode it in the depth, if we try to have a deeper incisive look, it will give us a clear idea of how the judicial independence can be trampled if we will infuse more of politics in the appointment of the judges. So it is very important for a country like India, which is a developing democracy. This is very, very important. Where the passion guides our actions, rationality don't guide our actions. Now, when the passions will be guiding the actions, the rationality will take a back seat. Politics will infuse into judiciary. It is very important. Even if the collegium system is not part of the constitution, even if we don't see a lot of connectivity between the umbilical connectedness between appointment of the judges and the executive over-assertiveness, still there is a need to preserve the independence of the judiciary. So this was all for this editorial decode. You can subscribe to this channel. Name of the channel is EIS Mentors. You can contact me at 845-94-0000 in case you're interested in buying the video classes on IAS Civil Services Preparation. And do participate in answer writing program on brainiki.com. And if you have any sort of queries, if you want to discuss something, you can post it on brainiki.com. We have created a special provision, that is a tab we have created. You just click on that tab, and if you have any sort of query, you can just put up your query over there. We will reply back to that query within 24 hours. And you can also install our application. Name of the application is Brainiki. You can find that application from Google Play Store and from App Store. So this was all for the day. Bye-bye. Take care. Have a nice day.